So what's important to remember among everything Steffi said is that I collect people. That's what I do. Among all my professions, everything that I've done, what runs common for me is that I collect people because I think they're the most interesting thing. And what I'm passionate about throughout our conference, throughout everything I do, is to redefine success. I think we have all come to think of success only in monetary terms. And I'm passionate about redefining that and creating new role models. So I wanted to dedicate this session called Life to looking at redefining success. And what do I think of life, you know? I come from India, which is a land of parables and poetry. So to introduce each speaker, to introduce the session, I will tell you a few stories and read a few poems. First, I want to start with a quote that says that life is not measured by the number of breaths we take, but by the number of moments that take our breath away. So if moments are important, why not? Just why not we make moments matter? And our whole journey throughout our conference, through everything we do, is to create billionaires of moments. If each of us get greedy about every moment we experience and make that matter and count it, there will be a race for billionaire of moments. And that's the list we want to create. Now, how do you become billionaire of moments? The math is, even if you take every second of a day and count it, it'll take you a few decades to be billionaires. And we all are in a generation of ADD. We want to become billionaires sooner. So how do we do that? So the only way you get to do that is that if you influence someone, you get to count all their moments also. And that's the way you become a billionaire of moments. So what I wanted to do is take this session to introduce you to a few people who are definitely billionaire of moments, but more importantly, they are on their way to make everybody they come in touch with billionaires of moments. Because the thing I want you to remember through all this is that the only thing that matters is the journey. It's not the destination, it is the journey. It's how we go about collecting these moments. So I would like to start off the session with a person who reinvents himself all the time. You know, some may think of him as a doctor, some may think of him as an evangelist for life itself, some may think of him as mind and body balance making person, and some may think of him as a person who now has a new hairstyle, Deepak Chopra. And what I want to tell you a little bit about him is that it's not that he's courting a new hairstyle. The reason his hair is like this is that he just spent about a month as a monk in Thailand, where he spent the day begging once a day and every night thinking about personal death and spending the entire day in silence. So I'm fascinated by this person because of what he comes up with on an ongoing basis. Whether you agree with him or not, you have to give it to him that he makes the journey matter. Deepak Chopra.
Thank you. Need to set the timer. Well, thank you very much, Lakshmi. Thank you, Steffi. Thank you, the Birda family. Thank you, everyone, for having me here. And I just want to start with a question. How many people came here by plane? How many people took some other kind of transportation? Okay, so now I want to show you in the next 3 minutes a much more spectacular way in which you got here. Can we have the first video from my associate and partner, Alexander Siaris, and our new company?
Thank you.
Well, so it doesn't matter if you're a billionaire, it doesn't matter if you're an entrepreneur, it doesn't matter who you are, this is how you got here before you got here. And there's a certain way that you'll get out too. I was just reading an inscription on a tomb, on a grave, which said, "Where you are, I once was, and where I am, you once will be." So with that, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the huge problems we still have in biology. After me, you'll be seeing or hearing some very fascinating speakers who are going to tell you of the huge advances in biotechnology. But there are certain things we still don't understand. How does one cell with a double-stranded DNA multiply 50 times only to create almost 100 trillion cells, which is more than all the stars in the Milky Way galaxy? And how does this process that we call morphogenesis and differentiation is not yet understood? There are lots of speculations, and one of them is that it may be a process that's quantum entangled, of non-local correlation, where every cell knows, not communicates, but knows what the other cell is doing without sending any messages, either as energy or information or molecules. It's a big mystery. The second mystery is, how do biological organisms function as an integrated whole? As I said earlier, your physical body has about approximately 100 trillion cells, which is, as I said, more than all the stars in the Milky Way galaxy. How does everything function as one integrated whole? How does a human body think thoughts, play a piano, kill germs, remove toxins, and make a baby all at the same time, while tracking the movement of stars and planets, because your biological rhythms are the symphony of the whole universe, the whole cosmos? Circadian rhythms, seasonal rhythms, tidal rhythms, gravitational rhythms, lunar rhythms, and rhythms upon rhythms in harmony with other rhythms. These are big mysteries, my friends, that technology does not even have the answer to at the moment. How do we perceive things? If you can see my red shoes right now, there are no red beams of light coming to your eyes. And yet, from your eyes, there's an electrical current going to your brain, neural networks are firing, and there's no color in your brain, but you're experiencing color. There's no color in the world. Sir Arthur Eddington, who won the Nobel Prize in physiology and medicines, rather John Eccles, once said, "I want you to know there are no colors in the real world, no textures in the real world, nothing of the sort." We all experience this in a domain that we have no idea where it exists, because if I looked at your neurons, when you're experiencing the color red, or hearing my voice, or experiencing anything that you call experience, the only thing you find in neural networks are electromagnetic impulses and chemicals. How does that become subjectivity? How does that become experience? How does that become thought, cognition, perception, inspiration, insight, choice, creativity, imagination? We have no idea. Arthur Eddington, saying a phenomena like this a few years ago in his Nobel speech, he said, "The best answer I can give is that something unknown is doing we don't know what." We could say that. But on the other hand, at this moment, there's some really a few very cutting-edge scientists, mathematicians, physicists, and biologists who are saying that consciousness, which is the source of our life, you and I are conscious beings right now, that consciousness is not an emergent property of evolution, but in fact consciousness is the ground of our being that differentiates into everything that we call space-time, energy, information, and everything that we call reality. Our thoughts, our cognition, our perception, our social interactions, our personal relationships, our biology, our environment, and even our interaction with the forces of nature comes from a domain that exists outside of space-time. One of the persons persons I work with right now is Stuart Hameroff, who is an anesthesiologist in Arizona, who's co-authored with Sir Roger Penrose a paper that suggests that your consciousness and my consciousness and the consciousness of all sentient beings is actually a fundamental property of space-time geometry at Planck scale. So that if you go 10 to the power of minus 33 centimeters to a level, order of being that is 25 times smaller in magnitude than an atom, you end up with nothing. So what is this nothingness from where the whole universe comes? If you read Stephen Hawking's last book, he said, the universe comes out of nothing and will continue to come out of nothing because of a law called gravity. What he didn't say was that this nothingness is also the womb of creation. That Penrose and others have suggested that this level of Planck scale space-time geometry has not only the fundamental building blocks of the whole universe as possibility, possibility waves of spin, charge, space-time, and gravity, but also the fundamental building blocks of what we call our mind, of Platonic values like truth, goodness, beauty, harmony, evolution, mathematical and musical truth. And this level of Planck scale space-time geometry holographically scales as the entire universe with all its observers, all its ways of observation, and all its objects of observation. So much for the metaphysics, so much for the philosophy. I think a lot of you are saying here, so what? How does it make a difference? I think it makes a huge difference when we begin to understand if consciousness is the basis of everything that we call reality, then we need to have an approach that somehow brings together the great biotechnologies, the great things you're going to hear about in a few minutes, with some of the wisdom traditions of both the East and the West, which said that consciousness as the ground of being is actually a field of infinite possibilities, a field of correlation, a field that is proliferating with uncertainty, a field that takes leaps of creativity, but also an intention field. And this has huge ramifications for our well-being. So this is a slide I prepared for you today based on some research that we have done at Gallup. I'm a senior scientist at Gallup, and shows the connection between what we call career well-being, social well-being, financial well-being, physical well-being, and community well-being. It's a complicated slide, and I'm not going to go through all of it, except to say that illness as a result of being unhappy at jobs is a very significant factor. In the United States, when we ask the question, how many people are actually happy at their jobs, only 20% could say they were. It was a startling statistic that more people die in the Western civilization on Monday morning at 9 o'clock of heart attacks than any other time, which is an astonishing accomplishment for which the human species can only take credit. No other species knows the difference between Monday and Tuesday. Your engagement at work depends on whether you're going to be happy or unhappy, whether you're going to have periodic sickness, alcoholism, depression, all kinds of illnesses, including cardiovascular illness and propensity to infections and possibly even cancer. Social well-being, extremely important. According to our research, you need to have at least 6 hours of social interaction, and it could be on Twitter and Facebook, by the way. If you send emoticons and tell people that you love them and send them a kiss, that's counted, by the way. And one can see that it has a very important effect on well-being. Physical well-being, we have been able to show with the data of others, including Dean Ornish, that within 4 months of your taking up meditation, doing exercise, sleeping well, and having healthy relationships, within 4 months, you turn on the good genes, genes that influence things like cardiovascular illness, heart disease, autoimmune diseases, inflammation. So your genes are not deterministic. Only 5% of people in the world have what are called mutated genes. If you have a normal set of genes, which 95% of the world has, then you can turn them on and off depending on how you think, how you behave, how you function, what kind of relationships you have, and how you deal with the stresses of your environment. And so, too, physical well-being is connected to financial well-being. Because if you're thinking of money all the time, then, and this is, you know, it doesn't matter if you're a billionaire, but if your main activity is to think of money and worry about it, as I heard in the first session, what keeps you awake at night, then you're not a rich person. Rich people do not spend money that they haven't earned to buy things that they haven't don't need to impress people that they don't like. So, here are five major breakthroughs that you should be looking at. The first is to understand that your body is not a structure. It is a process. It's a verb in action, a process of renewal. The human body reinvents itself once a year. 98% of the atoms you have in the body were not there a year ago. At the atomic level, you recycle your stomach lining every 5 days, your liver every 6 weeks, your skeleton every 3 months, and even your DNA, which holds the memories of millions of years of evolutionary time, the actual raw material comes and goes every 6 weeks, like migratory birds. So this physical body that I'm using right now to manufacture this lecture is my 2011 model. The last time I came to Germany wasn't this body, it was the same suitcase. So you have to ask, what are we? Who are we? If you think you are your physical body, you have a bit of a problem. Which one are you talking about? Okay, so your body is not a structure. Your genes are not deterministic with certain exceptions. You can change your relationship with time. If you're the kind of person who's saying, I'm running out of time all the time, then your biological clock will speed up. You'll have faster heart rate, jittery platelets with high levels of adrenaline, and if you suddenly drop dead of a heart attack, then you've run out of time. We metabolize the experience of time into biological aging, and now there's research on what happens to telomeres, telomerase, the enzyme that controls the buttons at the end of our chromosomes, and how they're affected by practices of mindfulness and meditation, and that awareness is the key to all this. Similarly, we have five breakthroughs on a deeper understanding of the realm that ancient wisdom traditions have called the soul. The soul is your core consciousness that orchestrates the information and energy in your body. So you have the level of matter, you have the level of energy, you have information, and then you have something that's organizing the information in exquisite ways. It doesn't matter what you call it, but there's a core consciousness that is orchestrating that. And this is the new emerging paradigm that we are beginning to see. The paradigm of neuroplasticity, which means through your awareness, you can actually change the physical structure of your brain. In just the last 4 weeks, we've seen a lot of great publications on Buddhist monks who, through various practices of attention and awareness, where they imagine, just imagine and think of acts of loving kindness, compassion, joy, equanimity, change the way their neurons fire. And there's a saying in neuroscience that neurons that fire together wire together. And so these monks are showing the future of neuroplasticity, where you'll be totally able to override your midbrain, activate your limbic brain for effective relationships, and your cortical brain for insight, intuition, imagination, creativity, and intention. The emerging paradigm, when you look at all the things that we're talking about, quantum entanglement, quantum biology is a new discipline. There was a Google conference on quantum biology just less than 2 months ago. And now there are biological examples of quantum entanglement, which means non-local correlation, which means correlation without energy or information signals in biological organisms, including in photosynthesis, bird navigation, ionic transfer, and the sense of smell. So you're going to hear a lot about this. And you're going to hear how this emerging paradigm is ultimately going to give us a clear idea of who we are as conscious beings. As the Christian mystic theologian Teilhard de Chardin once said, we are not human beings, we are spiritual beings who are having an occasional human experience. And so as we move into the future, we're going to be really for the first time be able to answer the questions of who am I, do I have a soul, does God exist, what happens to me after my die, and first of all, why is there something instead of nothing? So my friends, my time is up, and before I leave, I just want you to do one thing for me right now. Just one thing. As you're listening to me right now, turn your attention to who's listening. So as you're listening to me, be aware of who's listening. I hope you feel a presence. It's not your mind, which might be saying, I wish I'd gone to the bathroom before the lecture. That's a conversation. That presence that you feel is a simple awareness. It was there before you were born. It was there when you were a baby. It's there now, and it'll be there after you die. And the great wisdom traditions say, hold on to that. It's the only part of you that's real. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Deepak. I think one of the things that's very important as we think of life, think of our bodies, is what we don't see. And there is one person who has dedicated a lot of time to this. Most of the time, we see the body as what we experience. We put the right clothes, we dress it up right. But what is inside us, literally, physically, what's inside us? And how can we look at it with a sense of beauty? So to invite the next speaker, I'll tell you a little story. In Mahabharata, there's a story of a hunter, a teacher teaching kids on how to hunt. So there's a bird on the tree, and then he brings the first student, and then he says, what do you see? He says, Master, I see a forest, I see trees, and then I see a bird. And the master says, you'll never get what I want you. Get out. And by the way, the goal is to hit the eye of a bird that's on the tree. So he brings the next person. What do you see? He says, Master, I see the branch. On top of it, I see the bird and the eye of the bird. The master says, you'll never win. Get out of here. And then comes Arjuna, who's one of the greatest warriors when he's a student. And then he says, what do you see? And Arjuna says, I see nothing but the eye of the bird. And he says, shoot. And then he gets the target. The point is that sometimes to get what we want, we need to focus on where we want to go. And the next speaker, Alexander Sierras, who I've known for over 15 years, has focused on what happens inside our body with the kind of a precision and beauty that I have seen no one else do. With that, I would like to invite Alexander Sierras.
Conception of birth.
When we
can you the mic on? Can you hear me? No? Got me? You had me. No? Okay. Can you hear me? Wow. Okay, stop the clock. What's going on? Okay. Can you hear me? I'm not sure which one it is. Okay. So when we first showed that film, it was like rubbing your head and working the computer and doing this thing. When I first showed the Conception of Birth film at the TED Med conference, as I was exiting the stage, before my foot hit the bottom, Deepak Chopra came up to me. I'd never met Deepak before. And so he came up and immediately said, only you can do consciousness. And I'm saying, whoa, I don't even know what it is. I thought, this is a little strange intimidation about, okay, where's the challenge here? But the thing is that what Deepak was actually referring to is something that we had been working on for a long time, but we refer to it as something different. We refer to it as marvel. We have been looking at the body for many, many years using various kinds of technologies. And I'll just back up a little bit and give you a little personal history. I was offered a position many years ago as the associate professor of medicine at Yale and chief of scientific visualization. And my job was to write algorithms and code to do virtual surgery in preparation for NASA, for the astronauts going into deep space flight so they could be cut in robotic pods. And because if you get an appendicitis near the moon, you're going to have to get cut. And so the thing is that as we were developing these technologies, we were seeing things that with the new kind of imaging techniques and with the new kinds of computer programmings coming along, we were seeing things that had never been seen before. Exactly the damages the hypertension was doing, the damage of diabetes. And as we were looking at these, we realized the fact that we are seeing for the very first time, we're in the front row, the privilege of not only seeing Genesis, but seeing other things of complete marvel. I remember seeing for the very first time collagen, and every part of your body is made of collagen, and collagen is kind of rope-like and it's opaque. Your skin, bone, muscle, everything is made of collagen. And the only place that collagen changes its structure is in the lens of your eye. It all of a sudden becomes a matrix, and for that reason, it's transparent and you can see. It's so perfectly organized a structure and design, it's hard not to attribute divinity to it. And so as we started to see these, that as we call them marvels, and Deepak calls them consciousness, we started to look at also disease states and looked at we could be the great educators using these visualizations to let people understand exactly how their bodies work. We looked at the statistics and we said 92% of diabetics who have a chronic condition cannot define to you their own disease. It's very hard to comply. It's very hard to be responsible when you don't even know what you have. Now, no one's responsible. Insurance companies are not responsible. Pharmaceutical companies are not responsible. The media is not responsible. And so we looked at it and we said, this is an opportunity to not only talk about disease states, but let's look at it from a point of view of wellness. So Deepak and I started this thing called the 9 Visual Rules of Wellness. This is going to be the Super Bowl of wellness events. This is going to be the biggest health event. We intend to have well between 1 and 1.5 billion people join us by this time. The biggest media event by September going into January. Every week next year, we are launching a major, major wellness and disease state. And we're starting here again with the 9 Visual Rules. Now, I'm not a big fan of rules. It always reminds me of the film, you know, the History of the World, Part 1 by Mel Brooks, when he comes down from the hill as Moses with the 3 tablets. I have these 15 commandments. I have these 10 commandments. It seems that rules are sometimes that arbitrary. But we have to start somewhere. And what we wanted to do was actually take every one of these rules and actually define them very, very clearly. So here, what we've done is we are going to actually pass through the first rule of wellness. Oh, is it working? Ah, fantastic, even better. So the first rule of wellness, we are actually going to take every biomarker, all these markers that are normally hieroglyphics, when you get them, your A1C, your glucose, your triglycerides, and we are going to define them beautifully so that you will actually be able to read your blood markers. People will be able to share this information when you get it from the physician, and you will not be restricted. Through these visual techniques, we are going to educate you how food actually makes your body. We're going to take every part and show you how vitamin D will make your bone, and when you don't have it, whether you're osteoporotic or whether you're just a little baby, this is exactly the same thing happens when you don't have the proper nutrients inside your body. And to show you how the proper nutrients are actually working, we're even scanning the nutrients. We're even scanning like an orange here to show you the beauty of not only the anatomy of these objects and these fruits and pieces that make us, but what we want to do is here's the orange and here's the broken out part of the brain to show you how each one of these ingredients are going to be taken down and show you how they're going to be rebuilt into your body. We have the ability and the technologies to see these. Exercise, people always think about it in the very, very cliche ways, but here, we're actually showing you a molecule here called BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. It is considered miracle grow for your brain. The only thing that makes brain-derived neurotrophic factor, that makes new neurons, makes new dendritic ends, and optimizes the neurons for growth and learning is exercise. These kinds of things have never been seen. These are molecules that have just been discovered. These are proteins that are just being discovered. Now, when you actually talk to people about, you know, your basal metabolic rate, what does it mean to actually gain more muscle versus fat? Well, here's a cross-section of a muscle cell. Here's the nucleus here, and these are mitochondria. These are the objects that are actually burning. The little blue objects here are burning all that fuel, that glucose. There are 1,000 times more mitochondria in a single muscle cell than you have here in a fat cell. So when you actually see this and you start to say, oh, well, why is it important to exercise? Why is it important to have, you know, proper muscle, stretching, these kinds of things? We're going to show you with evidence-based science what this all means. But what also happens in these kinds of situations when we do not care for ourselves, I'll give an example in the form of a story. Here's a person who wants to live a full and rich life. And in this, you start to see this old man who has a 10,000-acre farm in Indiana, wants to live to see his grandchildren grow up. But been a bit abusive of his body, and so now he's in stage 5 chronic kidney disease. Completely shriveled up, he's got to go into dialysis, definitely has to have a kidney transplant. Fortunately, his son-in-law has a match. And so he's producing a lot of red blood cells, erythropoietin, in order to give him the energy, and they're going to have to go. Obviously go through the transplantation process. But this is the beauty of visualization. What we did is we came up with a new technology, a 900 nanometer wavelength microscope, 2-photon microscope, basically using a Winstar Munchkin mouse where you could actually keep the glomeruli close up to the cortex, and we could actually scan them in 5D. Now, as technical as that may sound, the most important thing is this: these glomeruli are the objects that are filtering your system all the time. You have millions of them in each one of your kidneys. And these glomeruli are killed by hypertension and diabetes. The beauty of scientific visualization is you can see this is a normal, healthy, robust glomerulus. Here is one that's been totally damaged by hypertension and diabetes. It looks like it's in an ashtray. So a lot of times people say, are you guys doing this for doctors, or are you doing this for the consumer? We're sitting here saying the beauty of scientific visualization, these technologies did not exist when physicians were in school. These are all new ways of looking at the body that we're harnessing and showing you. Because of obesity, because of drinking, because of smoking, because of hypertension, we are now being able to see the damages and the beauty of when we actually treat our body well. We went through the transplant process, and we actually took his kidney, did the virtual surgery on him in advance, and planned his surgery. And what happens is you actually put it at the bottom. It's called a false pelvis. You actually keep the other two kidneys, which is pretty curious. And in the end, it all turned out well. He with his three kidneys, he with his one, walking down the fields. But unfortunately, as lovely as the story ended up, it's still, he will be on immunosuppressants the rest of his life. The family will be compromised. He will have to be monitored. This is very difficult. And most importantly, it was almost totally preventable. These are the kinds of things that we actually have to look at. But in our storytelling, the most important thing is the word story. Story is what gives soul to data. And the thing is, what happens is that we have, you know, we have 150 terabytes of data, of XYZ coordinates, of everything from the molecular to the gross anatomy that represents every part of your body. But it's soulless until it becomes someone's sister, brother, mother, father, or friend. No one's life has ever been changed by a pie chart. And story is the critical way to make this come alive. And we will tell all of these in deep story form. Now, coming back to the next story of abuse, the beauty of our bodies is that we have a balance. The body, the very first time you go into a biology class, the first two pages talks about homeostasis, balance. The body starts off with a stomach of one to, you know, a chickpea. It goes on to the size of a grape to 3 to 6 days, 1 week to 6 weeks, a strawberry. Then it becomes the size of a grapefruit at 6 months to 1 year. And what happens here is that over time, this is the normal size. And then what happens when we start to eat too much and we binge? These are the vagus nerves here that are starting to actually, that communicate, that surround, innervate our internal organs that tell us we are full. And what happens is that we throw the homeostasis completely out of whack. We are the ones who are actually pushing our bodies to the limit where the body cannot actually find its balance any longer. So as Deepak is speaking about it from the spiritual manner, I'm speaking about it from the physical manner of what we can actually see, the beauty of the homogeneity of the body speaking to all different parts of itself. The thing is, we are abusing it. But also take a look at when you think about sleep. Here's an example of a molecule that was discovered by a professor at
Rockefeller University in 1985, leptin. This is the molecule that is in fat, liver, spleen, and many cells, but it's also the molecule that tells you you're sated. I'm full. I've had enough. And one of the things that we found that it went in sleep, if you have not slept enough, the leptin sections of your body, or the leptin molecule, is reduced significantly. So you get up in the morning and you are hungry. You have a molecule called ghrelin that's in the stomach that says, I'm hungry. You have leptin that tells you you're full. You again, because of the lack of sleep, because of chronic stress, because of these kinds of things, we are again throwing this magnificent, you know, dance of hormones and conversations that are going on inside our body. We are throwing them off. And the damage it's doing, normal size mammary gland, this is a critical part for learning and memory inside your brain. Lack of sleep just basically erodes it. What's another thing that basically creates erosion? We just did a new cover story on the trends of neuroscience with the Dean of Neurobiology, John Morrison, at Mount Sinai University. We were scanning corticosteroids effects on neurons. We scanned the highest resolution neuron ever from corticosteroids. This is it. And one of the things that we found, stress, chronic stress. I'm not talking about, you know, running away in the Serengeti as we were supposed to be, you know, one-time acute stress, but chronic stress basically erodes the smaller dendritic ends of your brain. It just basically erodes it. And what happens from here, when you start to take a look at what it does, the brain just basically fills up with liquid. You're seeing the cerebral cortex just basically melt down. We are destroying ourselves through a society of kind of indifference to the homogeneity and the homeostasis of our body. One of the big parts that we're doing in the ninth vision here is that we're trying to also scan, what does joy mean? As we know what happens to our neurons in our body when basically we abuse it, what happens when we treat it well? What happens when you're a good parent? Does that neuron grow in exactly the same way that in the inverse of when you abuse it? Or is it an optimization? We have so little knowledge of the biological aspects of doing well to our body. And these are some of the parts of the things that we are now beginning to research in a way that has never been seen before. We have control over our lives. We have control over the abilities and the potentials of our lives by basically controlling how we live our lives. Now, I'm going to show you a short film. Could you share that, please, and then turn it on? Thank you. Now, this is not in the abstract. We have started a new program. Thank you. We have started a new program. If you go on our website, the Visual MD, and you go to our wellness section, reverse aging, we actually took someone, the lyricist from the Grateful Dead, who basically just basically kicked the hell out of his body. And I saw him at a number of the TED conferences, and every time I saw him, it looked like he had aged, you know, 10 years and six months. And so we took him and we created a program. I wrote a protocol where we actually reversed his biomarkers by 30 years and 4 months. And we've been doing it. We're building a new program called with Deepak called My Wellness Story, where we have been taking people, scanning full body scans and doing complete biomarkers, increasing their muscle mass within 4 months and getting everyone off of medication, reversing biomarkers by up to 30 years in less than 4 to 5 months. These programs are going to be made available and next year as we continue to write these programs. The 9 Visual Rules of Wellness is the greatest educational program in the category of wellness and disease management. Then what we need to do is be able to personalize it in the form of My Wellness Story by allowing people to tell the story of their life using these visuals to understand their future. You all have the capacity. And if we don't do it, fundamentally, what happens is that we're given this pristine cardiovascular system the first day we're born. Our parents sometimes screw it up, but we definitely then take the mantle on. And this is what happens. At the age of 75, you see, look at the internal. At that age, you could be running a triathlon. Here, your body is totally compromised. You are dead, or you are basically, you know, tremendously incapacitated. We have control. And what we're doing is building these tools and these visualizations to give you the primary first understanding of really the magnificence, the magic of the biology of what's going on inside you, and then the tools to manage your life. One of the reasons that we're here is actually we're looking for media partners across the world as we are going to launch this big event. And what we want to do is that one of the things that we've realized is this very expensive process. I mean, we're raising $50 million to actually do the visualization part, the science. That is the expensive part. The biology of our bodies are the same, whether it's the embryo in Japan or Germany or Athens. But the thing is, treatment is local. So what we want to do is find local partners in Germany so that when people see this and they want to know where to be treated in Munich, Berlin, Hamburg, any one of these cities, there are references as to where they go. We're going to give you the universal information, and then our partners will give you the local. And I think we have a plan here to make some real impact. And I thank you very, very much. Where you got to go? Where you going?
So now that we have taken a journey through what we are both inside and out, the next question we need to look at is, I'll tell you through a small story. You know, somebody asked Swami Vivekananda, a blind person asked Swami Vivekananda, that can there be anything worse than losing one's sight? And he told him, yes, losing one's vision. I think it's important for us not just to have sight, but a vision. And I would like to call on to the next person who's been very well known for painting a vision of where we are going. Juan Enrique.
Combination of abstract and physical. Really
spectacular. Yep.
Great job.
Wander up to the first slide, that'd be great. So Deepak's told you what's happening, and you've now seen what happens over 9 months. And I'm going to speculate a little bit what happens over the next, call it 100 years. So I'm publishing a book in about 4 days with Steve Gullens on Homo evolutus. And to do that, I'm going to talk about what used to be here. So a long, long time ago, there was absolutely nothing. The universe looked like this. And then you have an unimaginable Big Bang. And over the course of the next few 100,000 years, you get trillions of galaxies. And as the story goes forward, about one-third of the way through the story, you start 14.7 billion years ago, and about a third of the way through the story, you get Earth sitting there in the Milky Way with the sun until life goes kaput about 5 times. So you get Earth about two-thirds of the way through it. You get 5 cycles of creating life on Earth. life goes almost extinct 5 times, and it creates the cycle of life. The interesting thing is every time life goes kaput, you get this explosion of new life forms. So life goes extinct and creates this enormous explosion of new things. And as you think about that in terms of human beings, about 99.9% of this story takes place before we appear in the story. So this is all humanoids, not just Homo sapiens. And as you put that in context, there's 2 theories of this case. Theory number one is, that's the purpose of the universe. That is the end-all and be-all of evolution, and that's what you're looking at in this room. If you think that the sole purpose of creation looks like this, or looks like this, and there'll never be anything better, that's one version. And that, of course, is gospel truth to most religions. Because most religions come out and argue that we are the be-all and end-all of creation. That the purpose of a 6 billion planets, of trillions of galaxies, of a whole series of hominids, is to create what's in this room, and there will never be another upgrade. There's a second version of this, which may come after you ask yourself a single question. Is this particular version that we have of the universe just mildly arrogant? Is the purpose of the creation of the universe and Earth and the Sun and the Milky Way and all of these galaxies what's sitting in this room? If not, there's a second theory. And that second theory is it possible to upgrade? And as you're thinking of the consequences of that, why don't you ask yourself at the same time, why is there a single human species? Think about a thought experiment for a minute. This is a beautiful bird, right? Love seeing these birds. But what would happen if everywhere you went in the world, every desert, every jungle, every cold place, the only thing you saw was a red woodpecker? And you never saw other types of birds like these. Wouldn't that be a little strange? So as you're asking yourself that, have we only seen a single human being, or have we seen 24 species of human beings? And as you're thinking about what it means to have 24 species of human beings, and by the way, we found a 25th last year, there is substantial evidence that human beings upgrade and upgrade continuously. And while you're at this story, one of the things you might consider is that we coexisted with at least 6 of these hominids. It was actually not unusual to see 6 different versions of human beings walking alongside a Homo sapiens. We've just gotten used to a single species on the planet, and we don't understand how strange that is. As this story goes forward, one of the reasons why you have multiple species is because 2,000 years ago, there were only about 2,000 of this species right here left alive. And if that African rain drought had lasted a few more weeks, you wouldn't have seen any of these. These simply would have disappeared. Now, as you're thinking about this, just for argument's sake, let's ask ourselves what might be next. So, how much does it take to actually create a different species? Well, all of us pretty much understand that we are quite different from Neanderthals, despite our strange cousins. But the real difference between ourselves and Neanderthals that Svante Paavo found is about 0.004% of gene code. Absolutely minute differences lead to speciation. And while you're at it, most of the genes weren't in the brain. The brains that differentiate us from Neanderthals have to do with sperm and testes, with smell, and with skin. Is it any wonder that we spend so much money on cosmetics, we spend so much money on soaps, we spend so much money on creams, we spend so much on looks? Because that's one of the things that differentiates us. And as we go forward, as we sequence the first 10,000 human genomes, I'm not sure if people in this room understand what's going to happen this year. Because as we sequence these genomes, one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to find a whole lot of differences between human beings. And we've been playing this game for very good reasons, because we absolutely misused eugenics, of arguing there are no differences between human beings. Even though we understand there are differences not just in height and looks, but in things as fundamental as blood type, as metabolism. As these differences come forward, one of the things we're going to begin to ask is, do you have an ACE gene? If you don't have an ACE gene, it is really unlikely you're going to climb an 8,000 meter peak without oxygen. Because every person who's climbed an 8,000 meter peak has had an ACE gene. And while you're at it, you might ask yourself if you have a 577R genotype. The reason you'd ask that is because 84% of Africans carry an ACT3 gene, 49% of Eurasians, and by the way, every male Olympic power athlete tested carries a copy of this gene. As this stuff goes forward, it's going to lead to some really uncomfortable conversations, and we're going to have to change our moral ethical systems to deal with the stuff that's going to come out of labs. These are going to be really interesting and complex debates. In 2008, aesthetic plastic surgeons carried out about 10.2 million procedures in the United States. The stuff that's going to come at you is going to make this stuff look like a joke. Let me give you a couple of instances. You can now begin to regrow animal limbs on animals like ajolotes in a lab. You cut off an arm, it regrows. You cut off a leg, it regrows. You freeze half the heart, unlike a lawyer's, it regrows. But as you're thinking of this stuff, you can also grow bladders in petri dishes at Tony Atala's lab at Wake Forest. Or you can grow tracheas in Spain and Britain. Or you can grow, just in case you didn't get the last issue of the Harvard Biosciences catalog, if this is not in your bathroom, here are a couple of pages. You can try this at home. You can buy your own little hollow organ bronchia, trachea, and blood vessel bioreactor and make your own organs. Or you can make a little heart that beats outside the body if you choose. As you're thinking of the consequences of this, it's not just our own bodies that we're engineering. It turns out that all of you are symbiotes. And I'm going to say that in the nicest possible way. There's 100 times more non-human cells in your body than there are human cells. If those cells were not there, you would die. Let's begin to explain this microbiome. So of these 100 times more cells that are non-human cells than human cells in your body, most of the microbes on your skin live where? Well, it turns out they live on your forearms. Because you wash your hands all day, but unless if you're a surgeon, you don't wash your forearms, and they're exposed. The least microbes on your skin live where? Well, they live behind your ears. Turns out that mom was wrong. Of the germs on your left hand, there's about a 17% overlap with the hand, with your other hand. You have a completely different fauna right here and right here. And as you go forward with this, by the time you get into your stomach, you've got about 165 times more genes inside your stomach than are inside your entire human genome. And those genes become incredibly important to how sick you are, whether you have allergies, whether you can eat tacos in Mexico or curry in India and get sick or not, how fat you get, how you process things. And medicine is fundamentally going to change, not just because we're remaking our bodies, but because we're beginning to remake our microbiomes. Let me talk to you about three different experiments and what the consequences of these experiments are. These are things that took place in the last year. So the first experiment has to do with pluripotent stem cells. In the incredible video that Alex and Deepak showed, you saw sperm and egg come together and create 2 cells, 4 cells, 8 cells, 16 cells. For the first 16 divisions, those are pluripotent stem cells. They can become any single part of your body. So it's a little bit like taking a ski lift, going up to the top of the mountain, and then choosing, where am I going to ski down? But as soon as you start skiing, then these cells become neurons, these cells become bone, these become platelets, and then they further specialize, they become macrophages, they become T cells, and these over here become muscle. Once you take that pathway, it's really hard to get back up to the top of the mountain. That's what happens in your bones, right? You're creating all this stuff in your bones, and it's beginning to specialize. Now, what did the Chinese do last year? They took this nice little mouse, they took skin cells from this mouse, they turned the skin cells into pluripotent stem cells, so they remade those cells into the original cells, and then they gave birth to a mouse which was identical. So in theory, you can take any cell from a body and turn it into a photocopy of that body, which in science terms is sometimes called a BFD. So what the Chinese did is they invented this basically ski lift. It takes stem cells or skin cells or bone cells right back up to the top of the mountain. And that is really important because this is advancing very quickly. So all of a sudden, within the past 6 months, you've seen patients beginning to create human liver cells from human skin cells. So you take that ski lift partly up the body. And as you begin to photocopy your body parts, as you begin to remake body parts, this becomes really important in terms of how long you're going to live. This might have some intimations of immortality for your body. But what about your brain? Why would you just want to photocopy your body? Let's talk about a second experiment. Experiment number two. There are people who are walking around today with devices that are attempting to record everything they see or hear during their lifetime. Right? People are actually trying to record everything that happens to them during their lifetime. As you record this stuff, this guy, Ed Boyden, is working with the fluorescent proteins that grow inside the ocean that gives you phosphorescent at night and inserting that fluorescence into retroviruses. Retroviruses are these nasty little viruses that get into your cells, hijack your cells, infect them, and execute part of that program. In this case, what they're doing is they're putting a fluorescent marker into cells in the brain. And the reason why that's important is because Ed can now image the brain using black light. So as a mouse sees, smells, touches, hears, moves, you can image exactly what's happening in the brain. And the really important thing that happened 3 months ago is he was able to do this in two different colors. And the reason why imaging the brain is important in two colors is because then you can image as binary code, and then you can download binary code of what something is seeing, smelling, hearing, memorizing, and it's conceivable you'll be able to download your memories or somebody else's. Experiment number three. We founded a company 4 years ago with the guy who sequenced the human genome, Craig Venter, Hamilton Smith, David Kiernan, and myself. And we decided to program cells from scratch, much as you build computer chips from scratch. 4 years and $30 million later, we created this little life form. And this life form is interesting because it's the first synthetic cell ever made. You take four vats of chemicals, you use robots, you make the largest organic molecules humans have ever made. You invent a technology to stick that into a cell without breaking it. You invent another technology for the cell to execute that code. And then you execute that code, and one species becomes another. That is important because that is going to change industry on a global scale. We have an agreement with ExxonMobil to make fuels out of algae. We have an agreement with BP to make gas out of coal. We have an agreement with Novartis to make vaccines. And we have an agreement with Asiatic to transform the agricultural sector. What you're looking at is stuff that's going to change every business, every industry, and is going to become the single biggest driver of the global economy going forward. And yes, it will also change mankind. So evolution has not stopped. Darwin is still valid. The fossil record on the one hand is showing extreme extinction, but on the other hand, we're about to generate an absolute explosion of diversity. And that is going to happen through a whole series of technologies. I have touched on two of them. I have not touched ethics, I have not touched religion, I have not touched a series of these things because in these 15 minutes, there's simply no time to do that. But what we are becoming is a species that directly and deliberately engineers its own species, and no species has ever done that. And because we are doing this, we are creating a new type of hominid. This is not just conscious of his and her environment. This is a hominid that directly and deliberately engineers itself and its evolution and the evolution of other life forms. And that is no longer a Homo sapiens, that is a Homo evolutus. And that is going to be the 26th species of a hominid, and your grandchildren will see this. This is not stuff that is science fiction. This is not stuff that is coming. The reason I use photographs in this is because I'm a historian. Everything I showed you has already happened. This book will be out in 4 days. Thank you.
So the final speaker of the day, you know, we have looked at our body inside, where we are going. And one of the things we have to address is what we call disease. You know, what happens to our body and an understanding of our body in the context of a disease and how can we grow beyond it. So to take us through a journey is David Agus.
Thank you very much. Can you hear? Great. I'm a professor at University of Southern California, and I'm going to take you on a little journey now about how I view disease and the body, and it's a little bit different than normal. If someone, oh, here we go. So the idea and the vision of all of us is we can take a prick of your finger and we can say what's happening in any given moment in your body. We can then do the appropriate thing both to treat disease and prevent disease. The problem is that until today, we're not very good at it. Some diseases we make marked impact on, right? Heart disease, stroke, dramatic impact because of lifestyle changes, decrease in smoking, and statins, a drug that can lower inflammation in the body that has had a dramatic effect. Diseases like cancer, we've had zero benefit on over the last 50 years. There's a problem there. You put that together with the fact that we're living much longer. So you look at these curves here, doubling around in our health life expectancy. So dramatic growth in how each of us are living. And certainly, if we can take some of the things from that last slide and keep applying them, those numbers are going to keep going. Remember, evolution only cared about who had good kids. Evolution didn't care about how long you lived. And so if you want to optimize to go to triple digits, it's going to need some work on each of our parts. And so what is disease? You know, disease in the body is exactly this. If I show a pathologist, if I walk into a pathologist's office, they'll tell me this is a normal cell in the body. And if they then look and say, what is disease? Squinched up, this is disease. This is the current state of the art in diagnosing anything from heart disease to rheumatoid arthritis to any of the neurodegenerative diseases. We have no other technology to actually diagnose them. It's pattern recognition. And the amazing thing about it is that we've all based this on infectious disease. So in the 1920s, it started to come out that you could take antibacterials and put them on bacteria if you had the diagnosis and give them the right antibacterial, and the infection went away. But we've based all of our treatments in biology on those same premises over the last multiple decades. And the problem is, no other disease is like infectious disease. We've had it all wrong. And so, in one sense, we have to start thinking of ourselves as a complex system and not in a reductionist way about thinking of a diagnosis like a bacteria. And so the patient is the system, whereas health is the goal state. And treatments are controllable variables that we can do at any given moment in time. And each system has a multiple state. And obviously, there's a temporal component. If I asked you your average temperature over the last 30 days, and you said 37 degrees or 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit, we'd say great, but you forget that in there is a 12-hour window when you were 40 degrees or 101 degrees Fahrenheit. And so measuring in real time actually matters. And so states are equivalent classes of history. If you take, for example, a cancer patient, you've got a lot of inputs. The input is your diet, the input is a drug you take, the input is a treatment, and the output is basically how you feel, where much of the state function in the middle is unable to be seen. And so the emergent systems, any engineer will tell you that they can manipulate complex emergent systems without understanding them. They can make a train stop without looking at every component on that train and be able to quantify it or map it. A weather forecaster can actually look at the clouds, the wind, the temperature, and could start to estimate when it's going to rain. And they're remarkably accurate in today's world. The problem is that doctors aren't weather forecasters, and they should be. Remember, Galileo will go out every night for several months and look at the stars in the sky and be able to predict after 4 months where each star would be. Well, he didn't even know what a star was. And we've been spending the last multiple decades trying to understand disease on a reductionist level, not necessarily to control disease. And so look here, look on the left, on the top left, and that is colon cancer metastatic to the liver. The one next to it is that under the microscope. It looks like cancer. And the amazing thing is, you show a pathologist a slide of cancer, he or she will look into the microscope and say, this is brain cancer, or that is brain cancer. And they can reproducibly predict brain cancer. The underlying genetics of each of those brain cancers is totally different. There's a clue there. Evolution, or a body, is selecting out for phenotype, what that cancer looks like. It doesn't care what its genes are. Yet all of us in the science world for the last multiple decades have been reductionists in trying to look at the individual genes instead of trying to look at the whole. And you think there's tremendous chaos there in how to describe this, but there's not. If I took an egg and let it sit in this room and came back 3 weeks later, what would I have? A rotten egg. But if I put an egg in this room and I raised the temperature to 99.5 degrees and I rotated it three times, I'd have a chicken. So little changes in temperature and gravity can turn chaos into something remarkably ordered, as we'll show you. And so DNA sequencing I believe in. It's a way to categorize disease, and I'll show you some of its utility in a second. But the problem is, it's an ingredient list. If you had two restaurants around the corner next to each other, and I showed you the list of ingredients in the kitchen, you couldn't tell me which restaurant was better. And it's the same thing here, is I could look at each of your 3 billion pairs of DNA, and I can't say the outcome for each of you. I could do some probabilistic things, like if one restaurant had fancy organic food and one didn't, but I can't tell you exactly what's going to happen. Well, technology is changing dramatically, as alluded to in the past couple of talks. In the Monsanto Annual Report in 1974, it was over $100 million to sequence a gene. In my lab today, it's less than 10 cents to sequence an individual gene. I founded a company 6 years ago called Navigenics. The goal of Navigenics was simple. It was to take advantage of yours and my genetic code and try to understand the future for each of us individually. Most diseases are preventable. If you look down this list of death, almost all of these can be delayed or prevented. And so the idea is, if we can identify what's going to happen to you as an individual, we can start to interact, and we can start to actually try to prevent some of these diseases. So each of us have 3 billion letters in our code, representing about 20 to 25,000 genes. The technology to reproducibly look at them very quickly and very cheaply really has only been around for several years. So if you look in the literature at high-quality studies looking at genes and disease, really until 2007, we weren't seeing many papers there. And now it's exploding. We're having upwards of 100 papers in this last year looking at genes and disease. So what this company does is you spit into a tube, we look at your DNA, and then we tell you your likelihood of 37 diseases together with a genetic counselor. Well, this is me. This is my disease history. This is what may happen to me. It's not deterministic by any means, but it is probabilistic. And certainly, that is important as we go forward. In the United States now, we do colonoscopy at age 50. That's when the risk-reward curves start to come together. Yet what do you say to the 3,200 people last year who died of colon cancer under the age of 50? Well, you didn't meet the socioeconomic goals of our healthcare plan? No, you start to identify technology to say who's more likely under the age of 50 to have this, and you screen early. We passed a law in the United States under our former president, the GINA, the Genetic Non-Discrimination Act, which made it illegal for employers or insurers to discriminate based on this information. So this is something that's here today for several hundred dollars. Next generation technology, well, this is what we're working on now, which is actually saying what's happening at a given moment in time. We can take a drop of blood from your finger and put it through a superconducting magnet and get the equivalent of a 60 gigabyte picture of all the proteins in your blood. Well, this is similar to taking a 75,000 megapixel picture of what's going on in your blood. And remember, in your blood are all the proteins related to what you ate, to your disease status, to what you inherited, to what you're doing that morning. And so we can know today, this moment in time, what's going on. And most importantly, we can have a metric to follow as we make an intervention to see if you can get better by some of the things we're trying to do. So certainly the goal here is that we can intervene. We can take that drop of blood and say, listen, you have the beginnings of cardiovascular disease. We need to intervene by diet and by statins, by aspirin, or whatever other means is appropriate for you. But these technologies are here now. But remember, I said before that we're not trying to be reductionist, and that's the key. There's an experiment done several years ago that we were a part of where we took women who got chemotherapy for premenopausal breast cancer. Well, this is the worst breast cancer you can get. And after chemotherapy, they were randomized to hormonal therapy or hormonotherapy and a drug that builds bone. So by giving a drug that didn't even touch the cancer, recurrence of the cancer was decreased by 36%. So the idea that you change the soil, the seed won't grow, is real. You change the system in a direction that cancer doesn't like it, it'll stop growing. Remember, nobody in history has ever shown that chemotherapy actually touches a cancer cell. So for all we know, it disrupts that system, and that's why the cancer improves. And the problem is that all of the data we have about our system is that our system is changing. So in the United States now, the big fad is taking vitamin D, and it probably is that in many of the countries that you're from also. 97% of African Americans in the United States are, quote, low in vitamin D, and close to 75% of Caucasians. First of all, it calls into question, what is normal? When that person upstairs created us, he didn't give us a handbook, or she didn't give us a handbook saying what's normal. We've identified what is normal. So if vitamin D deficiency is going up exponentially because we're all staying indoors, how can you explain the fact that hip fracture incidence is declining dramatically? Doesn't make total sense. And in fact, if you take women and give them high doses of vitamin D annually to increase their level by 50% in their blood, you actually increase the number of bone fractures they get, not decrease them. You have to think of this as a network and not a node. Remember, there's a vitamin D, there's a vitamin D receptor, and there are about a dozen signaling molecules after them. So by measuring one node of a network, it is somewhat irrelevant. And then the body builds in loops. What's our mechanism for not having too much vitamin D in the body? We tan. That's the reason we evolved tanning, is to block the absorption of vitamin D. And so when we try to overcome that by taking a pill, we screw up the system. We actually downregulate the receptors as a way to protect the body from so much vitamin D, and you get things like fracture. In fact, in the Women's Health Initiative, where over 30,000 women were given calcium and vitamin D, there was no change in hip fracture rate by taking calcium and vitamin D. Yet there are staggering industries built on pushing people to say, listen, we need calcium and vitamin D as your bone density gets lower. The problem is it doesn't do anything. And so as we go forward, I just want to leave you with an idea. And the idea is, what is our metrics for health? The metric is to actually look at our whole system. It's not to look at our cholesterol number. It's not to look at our calcium level or our vitamin D level. But we have to start to look at the system and quantify the system. If you had a cancer My goal isn't necessarily to shrink the cancer, it's actually to make you live longer. And those are different metrics and different ways of thinking about disease. Well, the previous talk beautifully started to target the microbiome and describe it. And remember, those bacteria in your GI tract control a lot of things. If you look at people from China and their incidence of prostate and breast cancer, it is dramatically lower than that in Europe or the United States. If someone from China moves to the United States, after a decade, their rate approaches ours. And we always said, well, it's the fast food diet, it's what we eat. No, it's actually the microbiome. That microbiome metabolize your food, and they control your hormone levels accordingly. And so actually, if you look at breast cancer incidence, the United States and in Europe, it actually goes by latitude, because bacteria change by latitude. And so as we go forward, I challenge you to think a new way about health. And that health is starting to look at that whole system and take a step back. Remember, in the year 1971, 91% of doctors recommended margarine and not butter for their patients. And they were all wrong. So with that, I'll say thank you.